to another free tutorial lesson. This time around, we are going to be talking about a few concepts relating to the discounted cash flow analysis, namely WACC, the weighted average cost of capital, and then the cost of debt, and then the cost of equity. Each of these is extremely important when you are valuing a company with a DCF, and they are also very, very common interview questions. So, for example, the interviewer could ask you, if a company goes from 10% debt in its capital structure to 30% debt, does its weighted average cost of capital increase or decrease? Or they could ask you, what if the risk-free rate changes? How is everything else impacted? Or they could ask you, what if the company is bigger or smaller than it is right now? How is its cost of debt, cost of equity, and weighted average cost of capital affected? So you need to know them for interviews, but you also need to know them on the job, because these costs represent your opportunity costs from investing in a specific company. And that's how you evaluate the company's cash flows and figure out how much they're worth to you. So for example, if you can get a 10% yield by investing in other similar companies in a market, if you're evaluating a specific company, you'd have to evaluate that company's cash flows against that 10% discount rate. What this means is that if the company's debt changes, so the amount of debt they have or the percent of debt they have changes, or its tax rate changes, or its overall size changes, you need to have a sense of how your discount rate is going to change as well, because those types of changes will make an impact on how much the company is actually worth to you. So that's why it is very important. What we're going to do here is cover a couple of the most common interview questions that they could ask you on this topic. One's about how a bigger company versus a smaller company impacts WACC and the other costs. One's about how going from no debt to some debt or some debt to no debt impact all these costs and WACC itself. And then some others. And we'll conclude with a brief discussion of how the tax rate impacts these factors as well. The most important point that you need to understand about these is that everything is interrelated to some extent. So in other words, if a company goes from 10% debt to 30% debt, that is going to impact both the equity and the debt investors. And this is the point that a lot of people miss. The reason this happens is because if you now have 30% debt, the company is riskier for everyone involved. The debt investors are going to get concerned because they know that the chances of the company going bankrupt and possibly not being able to repay that debt have now gone up. But even if you're an equity investor, you are also now more concerned because the company's chances of going bankrupt have gone up. And there's a good chance, or at least a better chance now, that you will also lose all your money, that the company's share price will go to zero eventually if it really does go bankrupt, and that your shares in the company will become worthless. Now, beyond just that, there are other variables, like the risk-free rate, which will impact everything in this analysis, because both the cost of equity and the cost of debt are tied to overall interest rates in the economy on so-called safe government bonds. So when something like the risk-free rate changes, it doesn't affect just cost of equity or just cost of debt or just WACC. It actually affects everything in the analysis. Now, the tricky part about all this is that some changes only make an impact when a company's capital structure is set up in a certain way. So, for example, with the tax rate, you really only see changes there when a company actually has debt. If a company is funded 100% with equity, then the tax rate is irrelevant. But if the company has debt, changes to the tax rate will impact its weighted average cost of capital and cost of debt and so on, because interest paid on debt is tax deductible, and therefore changing the tax rate is going to impact how much of a benefit there is from debt. So let's go down and take a look at some of what we're going to go through here. I have below here that familiar graph that you've probably seen many times before on the cost of debt, the cost of equity, and the cost of capital. And we'll be going through this and looking at how some of these changes affect everything using this graph. To start with, let's go to the top of this table and look at how a few changes about the market that you're in and also whether a company is smaller or bigger impact all of these. So if a company is smaller, generally it's going to have a higher cost of equity, a higher cost of debt, a higher WACC, and therefore the implied value from a DCF for the company will be lower because the discount rate is higher. And if a company is bigger, all these are generally going to be lower and the implied value will be higher as a result. Now, the reason for this, put simply, is that smaller companies are riskier. With greater risk comes greater potential for returns, but there's that greater risk as well. And so lenders are going to be much more reluctant to lend in a smaller company with less financial resources than they will be to lend to a bigger company. So the cost of debt is going to be higher. The cost of equity is also going to be higher because the equity investors are going to demand a higher return because the company is smaller. It could go out of business more easily. Anything could happen. And as a result, both cost of equity and cost of debt are higher, and so is weighted average cost of capital. Now, with this scenario, with being in an emerging market, it's pretty much the same exact thing, where if you have two companies that are exactly the same, but one is in an emerging market, one's in a developed market, chances are the cost of equity, cost of debt, and WACC are going to be lower for the company in a developed market and higher for the one in an emerging market. And as a result, the value from a DCF will be lower for the one in an emerging market. Why? Because there's a lot more political risk. What if, for example, the government gets taken over by a certain faction, or what if there's an invasion of the country, or what if the economy collapses or the currency collapses, or a whole host of other things could happen. The bottom line is that there's more risk, and that is what these costs and the weighted average cost of capital have to factor in. Now, what about these changes with going from no debt to some debt or some debt to no debt? So this gets confusing and a lot of people mix this up. Let's take a look at this chart below to see what happens. So the way this is set up, if you go in and take a look at all the formulas here, essentially what we're saying is that as a company's total debt percentage increases, so as it goes from 0% debt to 90% debt, which is an extreme example, but let's just go with that for now, the interest rate that it pays on debt is going to go up. And here we have the risk spread. So the risk-free rate plus this number will give us the pre-tax cost of debt. This goes up from around 1% to 10%. Why? Because as the company takes on more and more debt, it gets riskier and riskier, and lenders are going to demand a higher interest rate, a higher return on their investment to continue lending to the company at this level. Now, as a result of that, the after-tax cost of debt is also going to go up because this is really just the pre-tax cost of debt times 1 minus the tax rate. Now, on the cost of equity side, take a look what happens here. The formula here, the risk-free rate plus the equity risk premium, which we've set at 7% times levered beta, this goes up across the board as the company raises more and more debt. And if you look at this, it is actually striking just how much this increases as the company's capital structure changes and as the debt used increases. So very, very interesting here how this changes. And what it shows you is that with the percent debt used, both the cost of debt and the cost of equity are going to go up as the company uses more and more debt to fund its operations. Now, we didn't get into this business with relevered beta and how this works and the debt to equity ratio, but we do cover that in our full courses and some of the case studies there. For now, I'm just focused more on the high-level takeaways from this. Then the last thing to look at here is the weighted average cost of capital. And so you see a very interesting change here as well. Now, the weighted average cost of capital is just equal to the percent debt in the capital structure times the after-tax cost of debt, and then you add the cost of equity times the percent of equity in the total capital structure. So that's where we're getting to this number. And what happens here is that you get a bit of a U-shaped curve, because initially it starts at a one level, it declines to a certain point, but then beyond that point, it starts rising up here. Why exactly does that happen? Well, the reason it happens is because if you think about it, the cost of debt is always less than the cost of equity, at least in this analysis here. So on the surface, debt seems like a cheaper funding source than equity. The problem is that past a certain point, debt and its costs will start to outweigh the advantages of that debt. And that is what this represents. Up to 30% debt to total capital ratio here, yes, the fact that the after-tax cost of debt is only 2 to 3%, whereas for the cost of equity, it's more like 7, 8, 9%. Yes, the fact that debt is cheaper helps you up to a certain point. But beyond that point, the additional debt starts making equity so much more expensive that WACC, the weighted average cost of capital, actually starts increasing. And you can see that in this graph here. So if this question comes up in an interview, when a company goes from no debt to some debt, cost of equity and cost of debt will keep increasing, so they're both higher, but then WACC will be lower initially, but then rise past a certain point. And then therefore the implied value from a DCF will be higher at first, but then lower over time because WACC is lower and then higher. Now, if you have the opposite scenario, if you go from some debt to no debt, you have to be really careful here because on the surface, yes, if you're going all the way from say 70% or 80% debt down to 40 or 50% debt, then yes, the cost of debt is going to decrease, the cost of equity is going to decrease, but with WACC, you have to be really careful because it depends where you are in this curve right now. So for example, let's say that right now you have 70% debt and WACC is 8.9%. Well, now if you go to 50% debt, yes, WACC decreases to 7.9%. However, if you are at 30% debt right now and WACC is 7.2%, and then you go to 10% debt, well, actually WACC increases now. So this question is actually very tricky because it depends where you are on this curve, and it's different for different companies and different industries. So if it comes up in an interview, the correct answer is it depends because we don't know where exactly we are, and we need to get this data to make a determination about how this type of change would impact everything else. Now, for some of these other variables, the risk-free rate, the risk premium, and then beta, these are all fairly straightforward. So let's take a quick look at these. For the risk-free rate, right now we're at 2.62%. If we change this to 5% and we look at our graph again, effectively everything here has gone up. Our cost of debt has gone up because this is based on the risk spread plus the risk-free rate. Our cost of equity has gone up because this is also based on the risk-free rate and then the premium over that we'd expect to earn by investing in the stock market. And then our implied WACC has also gone up because both of those have gone up. And vice versa. If we decrease this, then everything there would go down. And it's pretty much the same thing for the equity risk premium and for beta itself because all of these are effectively going to increase WACC when they are higher, because it means that equity investors are going to expect a higher return, therefore pushing up WACC. The impact on cost of debt is less predictable for the equity risk premium and beta because they're not quite as closely linked to prevailing interest rates in the economy. So I've listed these as NA, but you could see different approaches here as well. And then the last one I wanted to talk about briefly is the impact of taxes. So I have a couple stars here, and I say that we're assuming the company has debt in the first place, and if it doesn't, taxes will not make an impact. So let's illustrate that and take a look at how this works. With the tax rate, what ends up happening here is that the cost of equity is actually impacted by the tax rate because our levered beta or our relevered beta here also depends on the tax rate. If you look at the formula, we're multiplying here by 1 minus tax rate somewhere in this formula. So this is going to be impacted by the tax rate. So right now we have set this to a 40% tax rate. Let's go back in and set this to an 18% tax rate and see what happens. So at an 18% tax rate, the cost of debt, the after-tax cost of debt has gone up. And then the cost of equity here has also gone up because we no longer get as much of an advantage from debt. Essentially, debt has now become riskier at a lower tax rate. And so equity is now riskier and our equity investors are going to demand a higher return. And then WACC over here, it has gone up in a sense. But if you look at what's really happened, the curve has sort of shifted to the left because now we decrease initially at first, but then we very quickly start increasing after that and starts increasing all the way up. If you look at it, we only get it to decrease to 10% debt to total capital, but then beyond that, it increases at each subsequent interval. So doing this simply changes the shape of the WACC curve. And in general, yes, it is going to increase WACC if you set the taxes to a lower rate, but only if the company has debt to begin with. To illustrate that, take a look at the first row here. We have an implied WACC of 7.7% when we have no debt. And if I change the tax rate back to 40%, we still have 7.7% here. Everything else below this changes, but this particular part stays the same because when we don't have debt, taxes do not actually make an impact. So let's do a quick recap and summary of everything we've been through. This question about WACC, the cost of equity, and the cost of debt matters because interview questions based on this are very common, and because you need to understand it on the job when you're valuing companies with a DCF. The most important point to understand is that everything is interrelated. And so changes that make debt cost more are also going to make equity cost more, because now you've introduced added risk to the debt investors, which means that the equity investors are also at added risk. Similarly, other variables that are more about the overall markets or overall interest rates, like the risk-free rate, are going to impact everything as well, because if your risk-free rate is higher, the company's value is going to go down because you now have more alternatives. You have the opportunity to invest in other types of assets, other investments that have a higher yield, and so this particular company's value to you is no longer as high as it was when you did not have those options before. We went through these changes here and learned how being a bigger company will generally make all your costs lower, how being in an emerging market makes all your costs higher. Then we looked at the changes with debt, going from no debt to some debt, and then some debt to no debt, and how these get tricky, actually, because it depends where you are on our U-shaped curve for WACC. And then we looked at the risk-free rate, equity risk premium, and beta, and saw how, generally speaking, when those go higher, your costs are going to go up. Your WACC is certainly going to go up. When they are lower, your WACC is going to go down. And then looked at taxes and saw how when taxes are lower, when the tax rate is lower, all the costs are higher if the company has debt, and that the implied value from a DCF depends a little bit, but generally it's going to be higher even though WACC is higher, because the tax rate also impacts the free cash flow from the rest of the analysis. So that's it for this tutorial on WACC, the cost of equity, and the cost of debt. You should have a better idea and understanding of how various changes to these assumptions make an impact on all of these figures and the ultimate output from a DCF analysis.